Good day, children. I hope you had a refreshing break and enjoyed the festival of good over evil. Today we are going to begin with a new chapter, nitric acid. Well, nitric acid was initially, it was initially called aqua fortis. Aqua basically refers to water, because it was just as transparent and with the same density as water, and fortis refers to strong. Actually, nitric acid happens to be very, very strong, and it is very corrosive in nature, and that is why it was referred to as aqua fortis initially. Later on, its composition was studied, and it was basically prepared from KNO3. The common name of KNO3 is nitre. Because it was prepared from this reactant, that is why it was referred to as nitric acid. Acid obtained from nitre. So, that is why it was called nitric acid. Well, nitric acid, its occurrence is in the free state as well as in the combined state. In the free state, whatever nitrogen is present in the atmosphere, during the lightning, lightning discharge takes place, nitrogen combines with oxygen and forms nitric oxide. This nitric oxide is unstable, so almost immediately it oxidizes and forms NO2. This NO2, being soluble in water, dissolves with the moisture which is present in the water and forms HNO3. This HNO3 remains in the atmosphere, and later on it falls down along with acid rain. When it rains, this nitric acid is carried down by the rainwater. When it comes on the earth, then it combines with certain carbonates, for example, say calcium carbonate. It will combine with the carbonates and it forms the soluble nitrates of metals. So these are this process of converting the atmospheric nitrogen to the soluble useful nitrogenous compounds is known as nitrogen fixation. Nitrogen fixation. I will repeat, the conversion of the atmospheric nitrogen into the useful nitrogenous matter is known as nitrogen fixation, or fixation of the atmospheric nitrogen. Okay, now in the combined state, as I told you about this nitrate, similarly, nitric acid exists in the salts, in minerals. The most commonly occurring are sodium nitrate and potassium nitrate. This one is known as I told you, it is called nitre. It is also called Bengal salt petri. This is the common name. And sodium nitrate is also called Chile salt petri. Okay, depending upon where they are found in abundance, they are referred to as Chile salt petri or Bengal salt petri. Okay, so this was its occurrence and initially what it was called. Now we will talk about the lab preparation of nitric acid. So, well, this is how nitric acid is prepared in the laboratory. Now, as I told you that nitric acid is very, very reactive. So, that is why all glass apparatus is used. That is one important condition. Okay. So, anyway, we will talk about it. For the lab preparation of nitric acid, the reaction which takes place is either sodium nitrate or potassium nitrate is made to react with concentrated sulfuric acid at a temperature less than 200 degrees, which results in the formation of their respective bisulfate and the vapors of nitric acid. Okay, so to do that, we take a glass retort. This is a glass retort. Retort is actually a round bottom flask only, which has its neck towards one side rather than on the top. The neck of the retort is on one side. And when you have to put something in this retort, we have an opening from here. So, you can open it from here and whatever you want to add, you can add. So, here we take potassium nitrate or sodium nitrate, either of the two. plus concentrated sulfuric acid. Both of them are taken in the ratio of 1:1 by weight. So these two reactants are taken over here, and then because again, as I told you, this is a very corrosive acid. So when the reaction takes place, NaHSO4 or KHSO4 is formed, which remains here in the retort only, and the vapors of nitric acid, they move. Now we cannot fix any rubber cork or anything over here, or we don't fix a delivery tube like you've studied earlier to collect the vapors of nitric acid, because they are very highly corrosive. So straight away, in another round bottom flask, we allow the vapors to go, and in order to condense the vapors, we pour the water from the top. Okay, a tap is put over here. The tap water condenses the vapors which are inside because the temperature is low, and whatever water is falling over here, that is collected, okay, and that is recirculated. Because this water is not coming in contact with the acid, it can be recirculated. So the same water will be used to just cool down the vapors of nitric acid into the liquid state. So this is where nitric acid is collected. The vapors are condensed into the liquid state of nitric acid. So this is how it is prepared. So the reaction which takes place is this: NaNO3 or KNO3 reacting with H2SO4. The acid has to be concentrated. The temperature has to be less than 200 degrees. NaH or KHSO4 are formed and the vapors are obtained. Okay. So if you are asked what are the reactants, either potassium nitrate or sodium nitrate is the reactant. And concentrated sulfuric acid, as I told you, they are in the ratio of 1:1. The product which is formed is NaHSO4, KHSO4 and HNO3. Now what condition is required? One very important condition required is that the temperature should be below 200 degrees. This is very important. Okay. And the next thing is collection. Collection of nitric acid, you should remember that nitric acid is prepared in the form of vapors and it is collected in a round bottom flask, which is cooled with the help of tap water, which condenses the vapors into the liquid state. Okay, precautions, very important. Precautions are important. I've told you about collection, vapors, condensed with tap water. What are the important precautions? Precautions are the entire apparatus is made up of glass. Why no rubber cork or wooden cork is used? Because the corrosive vapors of nitric acid is likely to spoil the cork. So that is why without any fittings and nothing, straight away the entire apparatus is made up of glass, one thing. And second thing is that we do not use concentrated HCl in place of concentrated H2SO4. You already know the reason for this. Concentrated H2SO4 is non-volatile, alright, and concentrated HCl is very volatile. It will immediately evaporate along with the vapors of nitric acid. So if one of the reactants is gone, the reaction will stop. How do you identify that the acid produced is nitric acid only? So what we do is that this acid, when it is heated, or when it is heated along with copper turnings, then reddish brown vapors will be obtained. And these are reddish brown in color. Reddish brown vapors will be obtained. So this is how you identify, except nitric acid, this test will not be given by anything else. So how do you identify nitric acid? That you heat it either directly or you heat it along with copper turnings. In both conditions, reddish brown vapors will be given out. So this confirms that the acid produced is nitric acid. Now one by one we will do the reasoning questions related to this. One is, the first one is the reactants. So why do we take concentrated? Why concentrated sulfuric acid used? Okay, one, it is very strong, non-volatile acid, and it is capable of displacing nitric acid from its salt solution. Very important. No other acid or no other substance can do this. Only this one, only concentrated sulfuric acid can do this. So second thing is, why concentrated HCl not used? So you should know, I have already told you that it is not used, do not use concentrated HCl. I told you because it is volatile. Okay, and so it cannot be used to displace another volatile acid. Even nitric acid is volatile, so it cannot be used to displace another volatile acid from its salt solution. All right. Then why the molar ratio of reactants is 1:1? Why? See, actually if you see, H2SO4 is a dibasic acid. It's a dibasic acid. So we could have obtained two molecules of HNO3 because nitric acid has only one hydrogen. This one has two. So we could have made two nitric acid molecules with one molecule of sulfuric acid, but we don't do this because we want an acid salt to be formed. Acid salt is preferred to be formed because the other product which is formed along with nitric acid is NaHSO4 or KHSO4. So one of the hydrogen of the sulfuric acid is being used in the preparation of sodium bisulfate or potassium bisulfate, because one of the hydrogen is used over here. That is, we want this to be formed because you already know if we increase the temperature, then it will lead to the formation of Na2SO4, which is very strong, and it sticks to the glass apparatus and it is a non-conducting layer. You have done this earlier also. Anyway, we will come to this reason also. But we take the ratio to be 1:1, even though sulfuric acid is dibasic an acid, but we want NaHSO4 or KHSO4 to be formed. That is, only half the hydrogen of the acid is used up in making nitric acid. Okay, so the second thing is that the apparatus, all glass apparatus. Is used. Why? Because it is very corrosive. HNO3 is very corrosive. Okay, and then second thing, because it can attack cork or rubber. Okay, then the third thing is why the temperature of the reaction should be less than 200, because the reasons are the same. If the temperature will be high, if high temperature, then it will cause damage to the glass apparatus. And if we can prepare whatever we require to make at a low temperature, why should we increase the temperature? So why waste fuel? Then third thing is that at a higher temperature, nitric acid will begin to decompose. Okay? Will decompose. And the fourth thing is that a hard crust of either Na2SO4 or K2SO4 will be formed, which is a bad conductor of heat, so the apparatus will have to be wasted. And second thing is, it is hard to remove. That crust is very difficult to remove. You can't scratch it, you can't melt it. So it is very difficult to remove. I'll write the reaction. Suppose NaNO3 combines with H2SO4 at a temperature more than 200 degrees. Sorry. So it will form Na2SO4 and HNO3. HNO3 will still be formed, but this product is going to stick to the glass and it is going to cause damage. All right. Now, one last thing. We will talk about the product. The product is, of course, nitric acid. Now, this nitric acid, see, pure nitric acid is colorless. But the nitric acid which is prepared in the lab, that has a yellowish tinge in it. A yellowish tinge in it. This is because nitric acid is very unstable. Nitric acid decomposes into NO2 and water and O2. Okay. So, this one is, this particular product is reddish brown in color. And because the nitric acid dissociates, because the temperature is high, if you remember, when we talked about the glass, the lab preparation, we saw that we are providing heat from outside. Okay. Now, because of this heat, the nitric acid inside begins to decompose and forms NO2, which is reddish brown in color. This one dissolves in nitric acid and imparts it a yellow color. Very important question. Why is it that the nitric acid prepared in the lab has a yellowish tinge? So you will write this reaction and you will say, because of the formation of NO2, which is reddish brown in color, this yellowish tinge is obtained. So if this yellowish tinge is there, how can it be removed? Removal of yellowish tinge. There are two ways of doing it. One, you can bubble either air or carbon dioxide. Okay. Now, I will just explain it to you. For example, suppose here we have taken nitric acid, which has a yellowish tinge. So what you do is, you pass in either air or carbon dioxide through it. Now, these being gaseous, they will move from here, and this gaseous component NO2, which is present over here, will also be expelled out along with these air and carbon dioxide. NO2, which is imparting yellowish color to the nitric acid, will also be expelled out. With the result, this acid left behind will be colorless. So that is one way. Either you bubble air or carbon dioxide, because it drives out the reddish brown nitrogen dioxide and further oxidizes nitrogen dioxide to nitric acid. So NO2, which is there, a part of it will be expelled, or a part of it will be oxidized to nitric acid. So that is why we do this. This is one method. Second method is, you dilute it with water. When you add water to nitrogen dioxide, then it converts itself to nitric acid. As it is quite some oxygen is required. This is quite soluble in water. So when you pass water through it, it will dissolve to nitric acid. So this is all we had regarding the preparation of nitric acid in the lab. Next time we shall talk about Ostwald process, which is the industrial preparation of nitric acid. All right, children, have a good day. God bless you.